on seclosounds.org.
Listen to the radio. Harry and Edna's want to show you heard it from the three bells.
Times have changed, and we've often rewound the clock since the Puritans got the shock when they landed on Plymouth Rock. If today any shock they should try to stem, instead of landing on Plymouth Rock would land on them. In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was a look on to something shocking, but now God knows anything goes. Good offers to who once knew better words, now only use four letter words, writing prose. Anything goes. If driving fast cars you like, if low bars you like, if old hymns you like, if fair limbs you like, if Mae West you like, or me undressed you like, why nobody will oppose. When every night the set that's smart is intruding at nudist parties in studio, anything goes. When the Mrs. Ned McLean, God bless her, can get Russian red to yes, then I suppose anything goes. When Rockefeller still can hoard enough money to let Max Gordon produce his show, anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and good's bad today, and black's white today, and day's night today, and that gent today, you gave a cent today, once had several chateaus. When folks who still can ride in jitneys find out Vanderbilts and Whitneys lack baby clothes, anything goes. When Sam Goldwyn can with great conviction instruct Anna Sten in diction, then Anna shows anything goes. When you hear that lady Mendel standing up, now does a handspring landing up on her toes, anything goes. Just think of those shocks you got, and those knocks you got, and those blues you got from those news you got, and those pains you got in any brains you got from those little radios. So Mrs. R, with all her trimmin', can broadcast a bed from Simmons, cause Frank will know anything goes.
What-o, Harry?
And what-o, Edna? And welcome, it's Harry and Edna on the wireless with a return visitor, because today is all about the bass and we're not talking about the treble.
No, it's the bass.
The bass. And fantastic frocks and outfits and some, and beautiful clothing. I'm like... very underdressed.
You see, I'm not helping you though, I'm just letting you go.
But explain what I'm talking about.
We have Faye and Billy from Throwback Vintage. Welcome to the show, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Cheers.
You.
And Billy, of course, has been on before in a different guise. I mean, we're not going to talk a huge amount about the alternative Billy.
Because I'm sure they'd all like to know why now it's alternative Billy.
Well, that sounds quite mysterious
it
when
does,
you call me
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
But Billy's about the bass.
Guessing. Yes, you're all about the bass.
You're going to tell them later or shall we?
No, you share it with us since you've gone down that road.
And I have to, reverse out?
Well, I'm wondering where you're going next.
No, I was going to say, Billy is the bass player with the Broadway Twisters, who, if you ever listen to the back catalogue, will hear their show.
Yes. We recommend highly listening to the show and for the albums.
Yeah. Right, so we're going feline with Three Cool Cats by...
The Coasters.
Talking all about how sharp they are, these three
we were commenting on bass.
We were. Billy said that was good bass. Is that the phrase?
Yeah. I wasn't aware there was a phrase.
Oh, right. Oh,
there is now.
Right. Now, we're going to go and talk about throwback vintage. You just have the next track. Because traditionally our third track is about V-discs. And I'm confused, Edna. What is a V-disc?
I knew you were going to do that to me. A V-disc was a disc recorded by American stars of the day. And they were sent over to troops, American troops fighting in Europe as a sort of morale booster. And Japan. Thank you. But they were done really as a sort of morale booster from stars of the day. And this is one of my favourite tracks. It's called Opus 1 by Gene Krupa and his orchestra.
Frankie can croon, and maybe old Bing will give it a fling, and that'll spot everyone a humming the thing. The melody's dumb, repeat and repeat, but if you can swing, it's got a good beat, and that's the main thing to make with a feed, cause rock and rhythm's ruling the day. So they call it Opus 1, come on, latch on and jump. Hey, 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 it's Opus 1, this ain't no time to slump. Maybe if Benny the King would do it in swing, and old Mr. G could rock it for me, there's never a doubt you'll knock yourself out if ever you should hear Opus 1. Was Gene Krupa with his orchestra and Opus 1. Now we're here with Faye and Billy from Throwback Vintage, which Faye, Billy, do you want to tell us a little bit more about what Throwback Vintage is?
Yeah, well, essentially it started out as something Faye was doing before she even knew me, is really as an eBay business.
Yeah.
Wasn't it, where sort of various bits and bobs that she came across, you know, and you ran out of your halls of residence room, you know, is the equivalent of a, you know, there are filing cabinets that are bigger than what she was staying in, and and so she ran this little thing out of there. Yeah, and then when we moved in with another, we just sort of like moved up a level, really. So now it's just it's an all-round online and at fairs sort of vintage seller, vintage dealers, if you'd call us that. But, you know, now we're just sort of starting to get into organising our own events as well, you know, so it'd be vintage throwback fairs and things like that. So forever expanding, hopefully.
So this is just the start, really, of what you hope is going to be well, who knows?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah.
So what is it that throwback vintage sells? Because vintage obviously is an all-encompassing word. Is there sort of any? Is it clothing? Is it furniture? Is it knickknacks, for want of a better word?
We make a point of being as broad as possible. Really, you know, I think there's it's such a diverse market. Really, we don't really like to tie ourselves down to even a particular era or style. We tend, especially with clothing, we do primarily do clothing. We do like to try and keep it as broad as possible. But then again, you know, we also, you know, we're always selling sewing machines.
Whatever we can get our hands on, really.
Yeah, you know, I mean, we even have like taxidermy every now and then, really? Stuff like that. Yeah, you know, we get used to them though. It feels like when we sell them, it feels like
most go in my collection.
Yeah,
no, really?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you've had a few.
So is that the quirkiest item that you've ever had, sort of taxidermy, or is it?
Oh, that's a.
We'll come back to
one.
That,
yeah.
One,
yeah.
Shall we?
Yeah.
It's always, I love asking people that because the things that people come out with. But clothing, we were sort of talking off air, and it's clothing from the 1920s right through to, we were shocked at this, the 1980s.
Yes.
People call that vintage now.
Yes.
Which is quite
yeah.
frightening. But is there a sort of particular era that people are more nostalgic about or sells better than any other era?
It really depends. I mean, like the 50s sell well for rockabilly people, like the 40s as well. But then for more younger people, it's more predominantly the 80s, because I guess it's more relatable and it's more current with current trends in fashion.
So what sort of 80s items do you sell, just out of pure interest on what people are buying from the 80s?
Dresses, yeah. Blouses.
With shoulder pads?
Yeah.
But even sort of gym wear and stuff like that really is like quite unusual stuff.
Do you source leggings then?
No.
We draw the line there.
Yeah. Leggings aren't a good look now.
No,
so.
Yeah. So they're not quite cottoned onto leggings.
No, something shouldn't be revived.
Yes, yeah.
shouldn't have been here the first time round.
No, I know. Let's not make that same mistake.
Yeah, absolutely.
So do you have sort of different views from people who are buying with regard to clothing? Is there something that attracts them to a clothing from the 20s or the 30s?
Yeah, well, I think, you know, people, like Faye was saying just then, people get into it for different reasons. Obviously, a lot of the older generations and what have you get into it for nostalgic reasons, who they are recreating stuff. But I think what you get with the younger vintage movement, which is very true on like the rockabilly scene and the teddy boy scene and what have you, is it is literally new again.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that was the same probably the first time round with that first wave of teddy boys and what have you. And it is just something new and fresh. And it's unusual because it is, in a way, it is an act of rebellion, but it's a smart rebellion. You know, we usually associate like rebellion and fashion statements with like punk and scruffiness and torn clothes and what have you.